Thank you to Justin and colleagues for inviting me here. It's a great pleasure to be here. And I've taken my cue from the fact that you're talking about the philosophy of technology to be perhaps a little more general and abstract than I sometimes am. And I hope you'll forgive me for that. It seems to me that we've in a sort of interesting historical moment right now, which in some ways repeats some things that happened in the 70s. We're sort of 5 or 6 years after a major financial crisis. New jobs are appearing that don't look anything like the old jobs. Society, a lot of things that seemed fixed and normal 10 years earlier no longer seem fixed and normal. And Marxism has come back into fashion again, which in some ways is, for somebody like me, is very refreshing. In other ways, it's a little bit, you know, there's a real fear that wheels are going to get reinvented and progress is not necessarily going to be made. And of course, the conjuncture is very different, so we can't just transpose messages from the 70s and apply them, you know, 45 years later, and they will still fit. But I want to start by actually saying some things that may seem to some of you a little bit obvious about what capitalism is, because I think there's a lot of misunderstandings among the new generation of young scholars who are now suddenly getting so interested in Marxism and in capitalism, whose life experiences have been shaped by something very, very different from how somebody of my generation growing up in the 1950s, what we're shaped by. Values have become much more individualistic as opposed to the kind of much more collective values that were around in the post-war period. There's a much more, capitalism seems to be absolutely, I'm really aware that this screen is blocking my vision of various people. Could I suggest that you move up a bit if you can't see, just because I feel I'm having to do this a little bit to see you. So anyway, capitalism, I think, seems now like something so all-pervasive in all aspects of life. It's encountered on your smartphone, it's encountered in the shopping mall, it's encountered, you know, in the way that you form new relationships. It's encountered in so many dimensions of life that I think people think of it in a different way. And so I think it's important, in order to clarify what's actually going on right now and how labour markets are being restructured, to sort of go back to some basics and talk about actually what capitalism is and what it isn't. So first of all, this point may seem too obvious to make, but we have to remember all value comes from labour. Capitalism cannot exist without labour. Capitalism isn't some separate thing counterposed to labour. Its value comes from labour. And so capitalism, in a sense, is a relationship with labour. It isn't a thing disembodied, for at least in the kind of Marxist perception that I follow. My conception of capitalism is as something which is a relationship with labour. But capitalism actually makes very contradictory demands of labour. There is on the one hand a drive to constantly subordinate labour and cheapen it, to find ever cheaper ways of doing the same thing, which involves all sorts of simplification and standardization and substitution of workers from the reserve army for organized workers, whether that's done through bringing new workers to the job through migration or through sending the job to new workers through offshoring. There's this kind of pattern of constantly trying to subordinate and cheaper labor. But there's also a need, an accelerating need, in the conditions of globalization, to constantly innovate, and constantly develop new ideas, not least new ideas for how to subordinate and control other workers, for which you need fresh new knowledge workers, you might say, with new ideas that can be appropriated. So there's this sort of double demand for new innovative ideas that can be captured for capital, but also for subordination. And that is quite a complex dynamic. Each shift in the global division of labour does both things. It changes the so to speak, it de-skills and standardises some kinds of jobs, but it also creates new kinds of jobs that are to do with conceptualising change and creating new kinds of content and so on. Second really important thing to remember is capitalism is not a single monolithic entity. It is made up of a lot of different capitalists competing with each other, using different business models and taking risks and constantly having to keep competing with each other. That, you know, the first company in the field with a new business idea can do very well, but then other companies start to copy it. You know, the first company to use robots cleans up, but then when all the other companies can buy the same robots on the market at the same market price, and maybe produce in a cheaper country or something like that, the competitive advantage of the original company is lost. So there is this constant competition between different capitalists, and some of them lose. They don't all win. And again, especially people who have been rather influenced by the Italian autonomist theory, tend to see capitalism as this just this huge all-enveloping thing that we all consume from and work for, whether we're formally employed or not. We're also somehow feeding the great beast, you know. And they tend not to see these contradictions between these competition between capitalists. It seems to me that's very important to be aware of. Which is not to say that capitalists, although they compete with each other, they also may combine with each other in the pursuit of collective class interests of one sort or another, where it's like campaigning against the EU bringing in a shorter working week or something like that. They'll probably, or giving employee status to independent contractors for online platforms, for instance. You might find them all combining together. The other thing I think it's important to remember is that while all value ultimately comes from the surplus value that's produced in that labour-capital relation I talked about earlier, in which it's the relationship in which the worker is producing value which is appropriated by the capitalists, and there is a struggle about what portion of that value the worker gets to keep to cover the cost of subsistence and so on, and what portion gets grabbed by the capital. That is the essential conflictual relationship, which the kind of knot, if you like, at the heart of how capitalism works. And so people read Marx and they think, oh yeah, it's all about extracting surplus value. And then they think surplus value equals profit. And it's not as simple as that, because as capitalism is a large system with a lot of different capitalists in it, some of them are directly producing value, surplus value, but others are making money in other ways. They might be charging rents. They might be taking a percentage from the transactions, various transactions between workers and employers, between company and company, between supermarkets and banks, or whatever it is. Or they might be, they're a simple theft. There is what's called primitive accumulation. There's going around and, you know, fencing off a bit of rainforest and chopping down the trees and making money out of that, or trade. Buying stuff at one price and selling it at another price, or rent, as I said earlier. And these are all, so to kind of collapse the concept of profit into the concept of surplus value is not very helpful. And you see that particular brand of unhelpfulness very visibly in the debates around, people who argue that every time you go on Facebook, you're producing surplus value, that you're working for Facebook. This is a very commonly held theoretical position right now, and which seems to me to kind of based on a deep misunderstanding of actually how capitalism works. Of course, Facebook makes lots of money, and of course, Facebook couldn't make lots of money if, you know, we went all there on there using it. But it's making its money by selling advertising. And that value ultimately comes from the surplus value that's created in the manufacture of the commodities that are being advertised, right? And as, from which Facebook or Google or wherever are taking a rent. And yes, consumers are part of that story, but consumers are not directly producing that surplus value, in my opinion. Anyway, so the final important characteristic of capitalism, which I think is very often misunderstood, is the idea is that value creation, value realization are the same thing. And people particularly argue that in these days of digital technologies, that things are so instantaneous that the value is created and realized in the same moment. And people who are anyway confused about the role of the consumer in creating value are particularly liable to jump to this position that value creation, value realization are the same thing. In fact, of course, they're not. The value that is created in this iPhone, which contains, I think, something like 68% of the periodic table in terms of its chemical constituents, that value is being created by miners, by assembly workers, by a whole range of workers along very, very complex value chains, and software designers and engineers and, you know, materials specialists and people who do the optics for the lens and whatever, you know. It's this cumulative result of the labor of lots and lots and lots of different people along these complex value chains. But that value is only realized when I buy it. If I don't buy it, if nobody buys it, that value is not realized. And this is a real risk. As global value chains get longer and longer, the risk, the concomitant risk for capitalists becomes actually greater. What happens if, while the ship is on its way from China with all the iPhones on it, you know, somebody brings out a new, a competitor brings out a new and cheaper model or a clone of it, or somebody discovers that the batteries are going to explode or something and nobody buys them. What happens if the container ship doesn't get to the dock in South Korea? What happens if, etc., all along the chain? And this is why the workers in the world right now, who in my opinion are under the most pressure, are the workers and pressure to speed up, to constantly speed up, are the workers, are the logistics workers, the guys on the container ships, in the docks, in the Amazon warehouses, doing the delivery, the final, what they call the last mile from the warehouse to your front door. All these workers are under incredible pressure, and their online equivalents, because the value chain isn't just a question of physically getting stuff, you know, from the mine to the component factory to the assembly factory to the dock to the ship to the whatever. It's also about the organization of all that and the processing of the orders, which includes call center workers. It includes people in, you know, logistics management, people in the fulfillment center of Amazon and so on. All these workers are under incredible pressure to get that stuff to the final consumer. Once it's reached the final consumer, you know, nobody gives a toss about whether you're actually going to use it. You're any more than they give a toss about whether you're going to actually use those Nike trainers that have been, you know, child labor in Indonesia has been so exploited making. You've chucked them back in the back of the wardrobe and never wear them again. That's fine as far as capitalism is concerned. But that moment of value realization is absolutely critical. So and you have to, so this is part of the story of how capitalism works. And it seems to me that you forget it at your peril. this discourse about digitization tends to write out this material dimension of things. So that's some general remarks about capitalism. Now, where does technology come in? Because that's what your group is looking at, I believe. So it comes in a lot of different ways. Oops, in the wrong order. How weird. Anyway, I'm going to put the whole slide up because something's gone wrong with my animation. So first of all, technology is not adopted just because it's there, right? There have been lots and lots of inventions that could do all sorts of things that are not taken up for a whole variety of reasons. It's adopted to serve particular purposes for particular capitalists at particular points in time, especially in periods of restructuring after the kind of recurrent financial crisis or crises of capitalism, like the one in 1973 or the one in the most recent one, 2007-2008, and let's not get into the details of the ones in between. But you know, the typical pattern is you get a crisis of profitability or a financial crisis, and lots of capitalists do go to the wall, factories close, policymakers get, go into a tizz. They think, oh, there's going to be mass unemployment, there's going to be riots on the street, capitalism starts to restructure. Businesses develop new business models. They use very often the atmosphere of crisis to get away with stuff that they couldn't get away with earlier, like, reducing people's pay or closing factories and reopening them somewhere else or whatever. Technology is adopted for particular purpose. I mean, nobody's going to just go out and buy the robot for the hell of it. They buy the robot because they've got a particular plan to use it in a particular way in a particular production process, right? So you could say that the technology is an enabler rather than a driver. But once it reaches a critical mass, once a whole lot of companies have adopted it, then the pressure for other companies to do the same becomes absolutely overwhelming. So it's not quite as simple as just seeing it as a optional choice to introduce it. That's the sort of my framing statement I want to make about technology. So what is it used for? One very important, and you can see it repeated historically over, back to the 18th century in various industries, is to standardize and simplify labor processes, which renders workers cheaper and more substitutable for each other. And of course can be used to make it much harder for workers to organize, because traditionally workers or organizations are built around sort of making barriers to entry into certain skills. You have to do an apprenticeship before you can be a skilled lathe operator or something like that. In the 1970s, it was print workers were a very clear example of this. They had very strong trade unions, they had very specialist skills. It was quite difficult to get into the trade. And suddenly, overnight, there was a technology that meant that anybody who could use a QWERTY keyboard could do what a linotype typesetter had done. And so suddenly their skills were redundant, more or less, which had huge effects on the organization. In fact, a similar thing is happening to taxi drivers now, and I don't mean Uber. the technology that's actually de-skilled taxi drivers is GPS. All those years spent learning the knowledge, it takes 4 years for a London taxi driver to learn their way to learn, and suddenly anybody with a sat-nav can do that. That's part of the underpinnings of companies like Uber. But it's not the online platform in itself, it was the existence of that underlying technology is part of what made that happen. So, and standardization, it's impossible to overemphasize the importance of standardization as as the underpinning for globalization. Without standardization, there are huge limits to what can be done. I mean, we can go back to if it was in the 1960s. Ironically enough, it was in the same year that Pete Seeger wrote the song Little Boxes, that they came up with the international standard for the size of a shipping container. And the minute you had a standard size shipping container, suddenly docks labour all around the world was completely transformed. They could move the dock somewhere else. All you needed was a crane, you know, to lift these boxes. And things could be shunted across borders, you know, absolutely seamlessly. On trucks, on trains, on boats, whatever. And that standard shipping container size was the forerunner of very many other standards. If you go to the database of the International Standards Organization in Geneva, it's now hundreds of thousands of international standards, not just for, things like sockets or, child safety features in toys and stuff like that, but also about labour processes, about stand and even management processes. And this is why, if any of you have been to Vietnam, you fly into Hanoi over the roofs of factories that say ISO standard such and such on the roof. Advertising to global investors that they do stitch clothes, to such and such an international standard. It's absolutely critical. And it's not just either in terms of goods and services, it's also qualifications now. A Microsoft certificate in whatever. There are tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people with some of these certificates around the world, certifying that they've got standard skills and therefore making them interchangeable with each other. Exactly like Lego bricks, really. The shipping container sort of is a very large version of, it's a sort of metaphor for what's happening to all sorts of processes all around the world. So without standardization, we couldn't have globalization. This is what is so bizarre about this Brexit thing, because everybody blames all these regulations on Brussels. They mostly don't come from Brussels at all. They come from Geneva, from a body that was set up by the UK in 1946. this demonization of Brussels bureaucrats. The standardization that's coming from Brussels is mostly a standardization that has tried to bring into law various things that actually, well, not all of it, but some of it, that protect workers, anyway, that's by the by. So standardization is absolutely key. And standardization also, as soon as you've got things that are in standard measurable units with standard sizes and so on, they become much more easy to handle technologically. So that is technology and standardization go hand in hand, if you like, in the same way that quantifiability and technology go hand in hand. To stress that point, the global division of labour that we now have has been cumulatively built up over the last, in relation to service kind of work, probably in the last 25, 30 years, in relation to manufacturing processes, more like 50 years, has been built up by cumulative, by applying the kind of logic of standardization, you could say. If you've got a labour process, the labour involves a lot of tacit skill, the only way you can actually manage that worker is by standing over them and watching that they do it. As soon as the process is standardised enough to have quantifiable results, you can manage by results or pay by results. instead of standing over them in real time and real space and making sure and that I'm having them clock in the morning, clock out in the evening, whatever, you can say, right, you do produce 210 of these by Friday. And it can be done somewhere else, and it can be done by a different company. So outsourcing and offshoring are closely linked to the production of quantifiable results, or for more complex tasks, performance indicators. And so the introduction of performance indicators into the public sector, which has happened over the last 20 years to an extraordinary, as you probably, I don't need to remind anybody, sitting in a university, that can be a prelude to the kinds of displacements in time and space, like franchised courses, you know, or whatever, that you see in other service activities in manufacturing industries, or indeed it can be a prelude to outsourcing it altogether to private companies. So that's another thing that technology can do. But there's also, of course, automation, which at the moment is sorry, you hand up?
Yeah, do you want to wait for questions at the end or can we ask questions?
Well, you can do what you like. He's chairing, not me. Well, at its simplest, to give you some examples, it's taking an activity like IT support, which 20 years ago would probably have been done inside a university, a local authority, a manufacturing company, or whatever. They would have had their own team of IT support workers. The IT support task gets a bit more and more standardized because everybody's using the same platforms all around the world, and it's all Microsoft products and SAP platforms or whatever, and the people with the certification to do the standard certification to do those jobs exist all around the world. It becomes more expensive, there's pressure to cut costs, and along comes a company like Siemens Business Services or whoever who says, look, you know, we can do this for you much more cheaply than you can yourself, outsource it to us. And that company, they will probably transfer some of the workers who are already doing the job, who understand the customer requirements and so on, might get transferred to the new company. But some of the other tasks they might be done in Bangalore, they might be done in Toronto, they might be done in the Philippines, they might be done through a sort of follow the sun team that's got people in several different time zones so they can work round the clock. That they may be on a three-year contract. When that three-year contract runs out, they might be transferred to another company based in another part of the world with a slightly different business model. But this global division of labor reached critical mass, I would say, in the period between 1992 and the bursting of the dot-com bubble in 2000. I was doing a lot of research in India during the 90s, and I kind of saw it grow there. There are a lot of other activities, whether, you know, working for Japanese manga comics, filling in the cells of the animation in Vietnam, for instance, or one of the horriblest jobs I've ever seen, sitting in front of screens in Africa, monitoring shopping malls in California to watch out for shoplifters. There are lots and lots of service activities that are part of this. Right. So what there's a lot of focus on right now is automation, the potential of technology to automate not just mechanical tasks like using robots in factories, but also increasingly AI applications that kind of automate the work of more senior service workers, like, you know, all these voice recognition systems that you now have to talk to instead of talking to someone in your bank, and, you know, those kinds of things. And there are the same sorts of scare stories that seemed, I'm imagining the 18th century people were saying, oh yes, but, you know, when they bring in all these looms, all these automatic looms, who's going to buy all the clothes? Because all the weavers are going to be unemployed, you know. And people make that sort of argument about, every time there's a wave of automation, people make that sort of argument about the working class, really. And they forget, I think, two things. One is that the automation of one manufacturing industry creates a new manufacturing industry to make, you know, the robots or the 3D printers or the drones or whatever it is. And those, they will also require raw materials, they will require designing, they will require maintenance, they will require, you know, new upgrades to be added, but they will also create new service activities. So you get, let's say, simple example, the automobile. First impact of the automobile was probably experienced in most parts of the world as putting an awful lot of people out of work whose jobs involved looking after horses and stables and that kind of stuff. But it created new manufacturing industries, you know, in Detroit and in Coventry and in Sao Paulo and wherever, making these new automobiles. But that doesn't stop there, because we've got an automobile industry, then you also need all these new kind of service jobs, like petrol stations and traffic wardens and, you know, other kinds of service activities. And then those in turn become automated. So you've got the automated self-service petrol pump and so on. So there's a sort of ongoing process of job creation linked directly to the new, the automation of, if you like, the old manufacturing industries. So you also get new manufacturers and new service industries. But what also happens is a substitution of goods for services. And this is very rarely predicted by commentators, because what people tend to do, like there are a couple of studies around that are very much quoted, from one from Oxford, one from, there's a slightly more sensible one from the OECD, all saying, you know, like 60% of all jobs are going to be hit by robots and things. And they always look, the methodology they use is they look at the jobs that are there at the moment and they analyze them, and they look at what's potentially, what can be automated. What they don't look at is the kinds of labor that are going on outside capitalism that have the potential for creating new commodities. And a clear example of that, going back to, I guess, reach critical mass in the 1920s, would be electricity. The introduction of electricity as a technology, again, it was predicted to, you know, going to put lots of people out of work, you know, who are involved in steam power and horsepower and water power and all the rest of it. Suddenly electricity was going to put them all out of work. What they didn't predict was the huge range of new kinds of electrical appliances that would be produced based on effectively making goods that substituted for services in domestic labour, either private services or work in the home, washing machines, vacuum cleaners, and also the entertainment industry, you know, where people used to just sing to each other, you know, radios, record players, huge range of new electrical appliances that substituted for what had been, you know, backbreaking, you know, people sweeping the floor or scrubbing clothes like this or whatever. So this substitution of goods for services is a very important historical trend, and it seems to be very much part of the dynamics of capitalist development. And we're seeing it now, again, let's go back to Uber, who everybody's talking about right now. Uber started with a business model after the financial crisis, when it was difficult to get credit. They started with, along with Airbnb and various other companies, with a business model that said, instead of putting capital investment into depreciating assets, like the bricks and mortar for hotel chains or fleets of cars or whatever, we will take advantage of the fact that other people are paying for these things and take a rent. It was basically a model of taking a rent. We will put drivers in touch with customers and we will take 20% of each transaction, give or take. So all the only investment they had to make was in the not inconsiderable investment, actually, was in the technology to manage the platform and to particularly to manage secure financial transactions online. That's basically what they were offering. Having achieved a considerable market share, dominant market share in many cities around the world now, what is Uber doing? It's investing in self-driving cars, right? It's completely changed its business model. It's classically, it's substituting, it's using technology to substitute goods for services. So, you know, remember some of the points I made in the previous slides. They don't stand still. They can't stand still, these companies, because the original business model doesn't work for them anymore. Workers are starting to organise and demand some rights. Policymakers are starting to regulate them, especially at the city level in Europe. Their competitors have come on the scene using the same business model, competing with them. It just doesn't work anymore. But it worked. It made them their first tranche of capital, which they can now invest in automating. Right, so that's substitution of goods for services. Another thing it can do is substitution of self-service for services that previously were provided by paid service workers, a kind of externalization of labor onto the consumer. We saw it with ATM machines. You know, they used to have to go to the bank to get cash and stand in a queue, and a bank, you know, a paid worker gave you the cash. Same in supermarkets, same in booking your travel online, etc., etc. There's been a huge transfer of labour from paid workers to unpaid workers. But in the process, actually, the kind of tailoristic control of the labour process also gets externalised onto the consumer. So the consumption processes are very are kind of managed and controlled in rather similar ways to how the paid worker was previously controlled. And finally, to bring this is because what I've talked about so far mainly has been how capitalists use technology to, if you like, make more profit out of existing industries and services. But the capitalism's need to expand, it's not just about a need to find new markets, which is an important part of it, which Rosa Luxemburg wrote so well about that. But it's also, it has to find new things to commodify. The need for growth is just enormous. Exponential, you could say. So there is this search always to bring new areas of life within the scope of capitalist relations in order to squeeze some profit out of them. And that can be what Marx called primitive accumulation, finding things that have not previously been commodified. Or it can be what I very... it's a terrible phrase, I couldn't think of a better word to use. I wrote an article, I called it secondary primitive accumulation, which is basically recommodifying something that's been decommodified, particularly public services and the commons, where you had, in the post-war period, in the 20th century, you had a whole lot of public services that were created, you know, to provide collectively provide, so to speak, use values directly to the population, health, education, and so on. And what we have seen, particularly in the last 15 years or so, has been a kind of reappropriation of that by capitalism to bring it back into the private sector, like either through direct privatisation or through outsourcing, like what we're seeing, the way the NHS is being hollowed out by private companies right now. So finally, another thing that technology is currently being used for a lot is new forms of organisation, surveillance and control of labour, where even forms of control that make it possible to control labour outside the traditional spatial and temporal limits of the workplace, like through online platforms is an example of that, but just an example of that. So where are we? This is sort of where we are right now, in summary. We have now a global division of labour, quite an established global division of labour, characterised on the one hand by migration of people on a historically unprecedented scale, huge waves of migration internationally, and increasingly increasing use of migrant workers to do, you know, the worst jobs. Also historically unprecedented concentration of capital and dominance of quite a small number of very, very large multinational corporations. The year 2006, just before the crisis, was a sort of world peak in mergers and acquisitions. And in that year, the growth on the previous year, the growth in terms of market share and in terms of percentage of employment of multinational companies grew by 20% just in 1 year. It was a huge, this was companies gobbling up other companies. It wasn't real growth. It was kind of cannibalism, if you like. You could have predicted the financial crisis, leaving aside what the banks were up to. Just look at productivity, GDP figures, because there was very, very little investment in new greenfield sites. So the growth, it was unsustainable growth. It was growth that was coming from just buying up other companies, not from creating new value. We've seen a decline of the normative 20th century post-Second World War model of stable employment that came to seem normal in a few developed countries in the third quarter of the 20th century, and which I think for a lot of people is still a sort of aspirational ideal of what work ought to be like, you know, full-time permanent job for life with a pension, you know. And of course we had economic crisis in 2007-2008, which legitimized further waves of restructuring that brought some things, brought to critical mass some things that had been minority trends up to that point. And we also have new waves of commodification based on, this is just a quick summary, biology, the DNA of plants and things like that, new drugs, the human body, you could say, nature and the human body as sites of capital accumulation and of the generation of new commodities, plastic surgery, makeup, drugs, you name it. Art, commodification of art and culture on an unprecedented scale. I'm speeding up a bit here because I don't want to talk about these things in detail. Public services are being commodified, as I said earlier. Private services being commodified, particularly the kind of informal labour markets that grew up around activities, well, like that economists haven't really paid much attention to until very recently. Things like people like window cleaners and dog walkers and babysitters and who are working cash in hand in the informal economy in most parts of the world, suddenly becoming the basis for new kinds of capitalist organization, which the online platforms, we've been TaskRabbit, you know, MyBuilder.com, HomeJoy, whoever, who are mopping up this kind of labour and rather curiously formalizing it, but bringing it with under the scope of sort of capitalist discipline and time regimes and, you know, forms of organization and control, putting the workers at the mercy of, you know, customer ratings and those kinds of things, formalizing it while leaving it informal in the sense of being precarious and without rights. But basically in the first stages, using effectively a rental model as Uber used in the first stages, just basically taking a percentage of the cost of introducing the worker to the client and investing only in the platform. But as I said earlier, this is changing very rapidly. And and in the process, of course, this is, these practices are being adopted across the rest of the economy, not just by online platforms, but, you know, you look at the growth of things like 0 hours contracts and so on. Those workers are really managed exactly the same as online platform workers, except they have a slightly different employment status. So anyway, and finally, and this is a really big one, is sociality, human sociality itself, is becoming, look at things like social media sites, like mobile phones, you know, it's a rent being taken from everyday communication that used to sit outside capitalist relations and now stands in. Now, I've got some diagrams to try and make some of this clear, but am I running out of time? Well, I just want to make it visible for you, just some of the dynamics of what's taking place in the labour market. So I'm going to show you a diagram with some animation, if that's all right. This is taken from one chapter in my last book, which is about the labour theory of value. So this is how I conceptualize labor. It's a bit different from Karl Marx, because the row across the top, he would have called that unproductive labor. I don't. I call it reproductive labor, because it's producing value for society and indeed for capitalism as a whole. And then the bottom row is labor that is directly productive for capitalism, and that's divided vertically into between paid labor and unpaid labor. So the top right hand corner is the unpaid labor that goes on in the home and in the community, which could be artistic and cultural labor. It's reproductive in the broadest sense, not just reproducing kids, but like teaching them to talk and sing and, you know, those kind of things. And I just want to quickly talk about some of the dynamics whereby these four different kinds of labour, paid and unpaid, reproductive and productive, change. In the late 20th century, we had the development of the welfare state on the one hand, shifted a lot of unpaid labour into paid labour in the public sector, you know, teaching, nursing, etc., etc. We also had we have historically, this sort of comes and goes. It actually, the better the public services are, the lower this is. But on one hand, social polarization, on the other hand, the need for women to enter the workforce increasingly, it creates a huge demand for private services in the home, for cleaners, for childcare workers, for delivery people, gardeners, etc. And so that shifted, that creates new kind of paid labor in service industries, but not historically within the direct orbit of capitalism. You then have the commodification of public services, which I talked about earlier, shifts a whole lot of labour from the category of producing only use values in the public sector to working for private capitalists in producing outsourced public services, like companies that are supplying IT services or cleaning services or security something, you know, people working for companies like Circa or whatever, who are working for companies whose purpose is to make a profit out of their labour. So there's a huge shift of work from that, you know, into the direct, that direct conflictual relationship with capitalism I was talking about earlier. Another trend is the substitution of products for services. So a lot of the work that was previously done fairly autonomously in the home now becomes dependent on actually going out, buying a washing machine, buying a dishwasher, buying a whatever it is, a baby alarm. And also a purchases of services in the market, or a substitution of, you know, buying in cleaning, standardized cleaning services or laundry services, or buying, going to a fast food place instead of cooking at home, buying ready meals and so on. So there's a huge shift of into this category which I call consumption labor, which is basically people who are buying things in the market. I will talk later about that relationship to the directly productive labor. Austerity, of course, pushes in the opposite direction. People are having to do unpaid in the home things that 20 or 30 years ago would have been done for them by the state. So that's another complicated dynamic. And we also have this very aggressive push to externalize as much labor as possible onto consumers as self-service. You know, you hang on for hours in the call queue for the call center, and they now try and send you to the website, you know, because they try want you to do even more of the data entry and so on. So that is putting a lot, creating a lot of new kinds of unpaid labor. And that's it. Sorry, that's just my diagram finished. So I think I'll stop there, as I'm probably over time.
Being described as catastrophic in terms of the number of jobs that are going to be lost. What is your, what's your opinion on that? In terms of self-driving cars, self-driving trucks, deployment of artificial intelligence, and stuff like that?
Well, I mean, there were exactly the same sort of headlines in the 1970s, and I was. And I was writing then about, oh no, there'll be new commodities, and everyone, oh, she's just a feminist, you know. I think they would say in the same breath, I think washing machines are a good thing. With that. Now, the thing, I mean, yes, it's catastrophic if you're sitting in a small, in Flint, Michigan, you know, or in Doncaster or somewhere, in because the new jobs will be created in different places from where the old jobs are. They will be done by different people. In the 1980s, there were, you know, there was massive unemployment created with the, you know, the kind of the coal mining industry and the steel industry, for instance, were absolutely walloped, you know, under the Thatcher government, and everybody said, oh, don't worry, you know, the new service jobs will be created. And indeed, new service jobs were created. But, you know, if you're opening a supermarket in Guildford, you're not going to employ a 45-year-old coal miner from Barnsley to do the job, right? So for some groups of workers, it is catastrophic. But if you take, you know, if you add up the numbers of workers throughout, across the globe, there's a cumulative growth. There are always scares. In the 90s, there were all these scares about offshore outsourcing, all the jobs were going to disappear to India. And the thing is that, yes, a lot of call centre jobs, particularly work, back office processing jobs, were created in India, but they were part of a sector that was growing anyway. But more importantly, The effect on labour in the United States and in Europe wasn't, it wasn't a quantitative impact so much as a qualitative one, because let's say you've got 10 call centres in the United States, you move one of them to India, you're sending a message to the workers in the other 9 call centres that your job could be done in India. So there's a sort of Damocles hanging over them. So they don't dare ask for a pay rise. So it has a huge disciplinary effect on labour. The fact that there is a reserve army out there that can do their work. One very graphic example of this, we were doing some case studies for a big international research project I worked on a few years ago, looking at outsourcing of various different functions. And one of the case studies was a local authority, not a million miles away from here, actually, I may say, which will have to remain anonymous, which had outsourced its IT support function. And first of all, they outsourced it to a large European-based IT company, and the workers were given a choice of transferring to the new company or taking redundancy, and a lot of them chose to move, and they were told that under TUPE, you know, the Transfer of Enterprises Protection Directive, that their conditions would be preserved, they would keep their pension rights and they would keep their same working conditions. So they transferred to this company, and some of them were absorbed into that company. And then 3 years down the line, another company got the contract, a small UK company got the contract. So some of them stayed in company number one and some of them moved to company number two. Company number two was then bought up by a much larger US company. And so some of them were now working for company number three. They were still sitting in the same desks, in the same office, in the same town, now serving the same clients. They were now working for company number three. And one of the guys we interviewed had, his daughter had cancer, terminal cancer. And he went to his manager and asked something that was protected by the original collective agreement they had with the local authority. Could he work from home 2 days a week to be with his daughter and give his wife a break from caring? And this American company didn't quite know how to deal with this request, so it went all the way up the line, you know, back to the head office in the United States, and back came the answer: if the work can be done from home, it can be done from India. Right? So, and that, I think, tells you about some of the psychological impact of this. There's also a huge, if you like, an ethical issue for a lot of workers. A lot of workers choose to work in the public sector because they actually have what you might call public sector values. They've traded off maybe lower wages for a better work-life balance, for feeling they're doing something for the local community, for feeling they're not feeding, you know, a big profit-hungry multinational companies. And they, you know, they care about their clients. And they find it a terrible kind of like a moral shock almost to suddenly be in a company where, you know, the bottom line is all that matters. And, you know, you give each patient 15 minutes and, you know, if you feel you can't leave that patient without making them a cup of tea, then that's your problem. We're not paying you for the extra 5 minutes. You know, that change in values is very important. But of course, it's a kind of temporary. It's kind of quite temporary, that moment when workers are in that state of, when they're still organised, they've still got the kind of expectations that came from their previous public sector culture, if you like, and they're quite angry and they're in these new conditions. Probably you've got about, a union has about 2 years to organise them, because after that, somebody else will be doing the job. They'll have moved on, somebody else will learn what they'd, there'll be a substitute person doing that job, it will have been reorganised, and the moment will be lost, if you see what I mean. Sorry, I'm getting distracted here.
The standard argument, both at the Marxist labour theory account, for that matter, in a slightly different form, a standard neoclassical cost theory.
I'm sorry, classical?
Standard neoclassical cost
theory, yeah.
Is that if technology means you can produce the same thing by fewer people. You can always produce more, either of the same or, as you rightly pointed out, something else. I don't think in the current reality that is true anymore. We are running robotics, information technology, etc., could be compensated by a growth rate of say 4 or 5%, a real growth rate of say 4 or 5% per year. The problem, however, is that we also have unpriced common global resources for which we can only bring within the market mechanism if we agree to own them. I don't see this is going to work during the rest of the 21st century. We are either maintaining full employment at faster growth, or we have an enormous environmental catastrophe. Take your pick.
Oh, well, there certainly will be an environmental catastrophe, no two ways about it, because despite all this sort of rhetoric about immateriality and so on related to new technology is directly connected with actually using up more and more and wasting more and more of the Earth's resources and combining them in forms that make it harder and harder to recycle them. I mean, this was in the 1990s when, you may remember, though, all the discourse. There's always a new discourse with all these waves of restructuring. You know, at the moment it's sharing economy, gig economy, crowdsourcing, cloud sourcing, talent, whatever. In the 90s, it was very much about the weightless economy, the new economy, the information society, the knowledge-based economy, digital economy, etc., etc. And there was a whole lot of, all quite eminent, highly respected at the time, economists were arguing that value was produced only from knowledge, right? That, you know, that we wouldn't need these material things anymore, you know, that everything was going to come from knowledge. And you think, well, excuse me, what are you sitting on, you know? What are you typing on? What are you talking to people on? It's physical stuff, you know, what are you wearing? You know, what's keeping the rain off? It's all physical stuff. And during this period when there were, as I said, there was a chap at LSE who perhaps I better not name as this is being videoed, who was actually, you know, extrapolating merrily away about, you know, how manufacturing was going to dwindle, you know, and we were all effectively going to live off air, you know, live off these new knowledge-based industries. But if you looked at the statistics at the time, you know, globally, steel production was going up, paper production was going up, use of just about every mineral you can think of was going up, more buildings were going up. You know, there has never been more material production of material stuff, which is so rapidly obsolete. At any point before in history. And the same will apply to these robots. This idea that you somehow populate all the factories with robots and then you just let them get on with it is, what kind of a capitalist business model can possibly work on the basis you buy your robots at the market value, you buy your raw materials at the market value, you distribute them in a completely standard way to customers paying, who can compare the price with every other company in the world. You know, how on earth is any one capitalist going to stay ahead in the competition under those circumstances? It isn't going to happen. They're going to be coming up with new ideas for new kinds of robots. I mean, leaving aside the fact somebody's got to clean them, somebody's got to maintain them, somebody's got to oil them or whatever they need, you know. It's leaving all that aside. There's this constant need for innovation. Just they'll become redundant as quickly as a mobile phone does, and you know they'll need a new kind of lead. You know, the sockets won't work anymore. You know, we all know what it is. I'm sure you've all got drawers full of a home of redundant leads that used to connect a printer to a computer and don't anymore, or used to recharge a Nokia that no longer is produced or whatever it is. There's just masses and masses and masses of stuff. And this all works, the infrastructure. You need bloody satellites, you know. Think of the consumption of the labour and the consumption of resources that is involved in getting a satellite into space. Think of the labour and the consumption of resources that puts optical fibre cables across under the Pacific Ocean and up the coast of Africa. And, you know, this is all material, physical stuff. And yes, it's catastrophic for the planet. Absolutely, I agree with you. But and of course the other dynamic of capitalism, it needs to constantly be finding new things to commodify. It needs to be sort of mining nature in the broadest sense of the world, including our DNA. You know, mining it to create new commodities. It needs to find new compliant sources of labour. It needs to find new markets, but it also needs to find new places to dump stuff. And I just have, you know, all this detritus that accumulates, and I have a horrible feeling that it's going to end up being dumped in space or something. But anyway, sorry, that's a bit moving sideways.
First question.
I'm sorry, I'm awfully deaf. I've got hearing aids in both ears. This is.
There's a trend now for products to be made from like recycled materials. So Adidas will, in the future, 100% of their trainers will be made from recycled materials, from sea waste. So there's kind of lots of companies sort of looking on this trend of sustainability and, like, you know, recommodifying a product that's now useless because of how the system works. But do you think this is really, is this doing good, or is it actually just like a way, well, it's just a way to keep costs down because it's a free material, but then that has to be extracted and it goes through the same mining process?
Well, I mean, it's not new, saving and recycling. I remember in the 60s, used to, you know, in Greece, you could buy flip-flops that were made from old car tyres, you know, and it's, and you can still, in Morocco, you can get baskets that are made from old car tyres. You know, people have always been very ingenious, and I come from, of course, a generation where you saved bits of string and brown paper, you know, after the war when everything was so scarce. But yeah, I mean, think of the chemical complexity of something like a mobile phone. Nobody has found a safe way to extract all those expensive rare metals and things that are in it. And reuse them in ways that are not desperately hazardous. I mean, there are, in places like Bangladesh and parts of Africa, there are places where, you know, in people's backyards, they've got vats of acid without safety protection, putting our lives at risk, trying to extract, you know, various elements from recycled electronics products, but it's a drop in the ocean, really. It seems to me that this is perhaps the strongest argument there is for saying, well, look, this can't go on. But, you know, people have been saying that for an awfully long time. Every time there's an economic crisis, everybody thinks, well, this is it. This is the crisis of capitalism. It can't go on. People can't be that dumb, you know. They won't elect Trump, you know. They won't vote Brexit. They're not that dumb. But anyway, there we are.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could say something about the way that the processes are working in higher education. Because it's clearly going through, you know, people talk about marketisation as a form of privatisation. It seems to me it's more like the proper commodification in terms of production and everything. So you're seeing the breakup of knowledge and teaching, and, you know, the outsourcing of teaching and the kind of automation of knowledge production. I just was wondering if you could say a little bit about that, you know, considering what you were talking about, but also whether you think that that's possible. You know, I mean, this is the feeling when you're in, like you're saying, when you're in those industries that are being restructured, you think, oh no, it's morally horrible, and you know,
suspect that what we're going to see is increasing polarization among universities. I think we're already seeing it, actually. You got your kind of privileged Ivy League universities where people actually get to still have tutorials, you know, to exchange ideas with people, and they are increasingly, of course, embedded in the system and make their money through things like MOOCs, which is an extreme form. Does everyone know what MOOCs are? No. 2 years ago, people, you wouldn't have known what MOOCs are. You know, because the Harvards and MITs of Stanford, Connecticut's of this world are very heavily in there, you know, using their brands, so to speak, to and their star professors to produce content for MOOCs. But meanwhile, the sort of adjunctification of community colleges in America has reached really extreme levels. And what's happening in the UK, as far as I understand, I haven't been following this very closely, that there's a guy called Andrew McGettigan, that's right, he's done a lot of work on it. But this allowing private for-profit American universities into the UK to clean up seems to be advancing quite fast. I edit a journal called Work Organization, Labor and Globalization, and I've just, as it happened yesterday, finished editing a really interesting article about the adjunctification of higher education in America and how it's not just about completely de-skilling and precarizing the academic labor. These people are lots of different short-term, that like VLs are here, lots of different short-term contracts for different universities, who are now completely having to manage online courses effectively. But it's also about producing students who are, so to speak, and this is his argument, sort of acculturated to entering the workforce on the basis that everything's going to be brought up into tasks, broken down into tasks, that you complete them, that you find the quickest way to complete your tasks, that you never know if you're being surveyed or not, but you know that you might be surveyed all the time, so you have to behave as if you're being surveyed. And the knowledge is broken down into these chunks, and there's never a chance to argue back, to argue directly, either with your fellow students or with the teacher. It's a very depressing, but a really interesting article. It'll be in the next issue.
What kind of situation does this put the state in, with these new dynamics, on the one hand trying to sell off some of its own parts to the private sector while keeping up with the welfare within the state?
That's a very interesting question, but I think we have to slightly problematize what we mean by state, because the United States of America and Uzbekistan are not comparable entities, and I think people tend to talk about the state as if it's a sort of the same thing all around the world, and it clearly isn't. You know, there are states and states, and some states have quite, you know, much more or less power than others to control the relationship between labor and capital on their soil, so to speak. I think there are a lot of contradictions, and I think one of the contradictions, which I think one of the things we're seeing unfold right now, actually, is that the gap that's been left or the contradiction, you might call it, since globalization has become so prevalent, which I suppose you could take, the turning point really was 89-90, that, you know, when the Berlin Wall came down and the whole world sort of was declared open for business, so to speak, for capitalism, and the world communism could no longer be demonized as an enemy, although one could argue that perhaps world Islam is demonized to some extent in its place, but anyway, at that moment, which in the early 90s, you can see the WTO was founded, the the International Telecommunications Union was set up to liberalise telecoms all around the world. A whole lot of things happens that put the infrastructure in place for standardisation and globalisation. And the shift of power between global capitalism, if you like, and national states shifted, but not completely and not in all states. Read Leo Panitch and Sam Gindin's book about the United States, for instance. They have a very interesting analysis about how the United States actually held on to a whole lot of powers that other national states didn't have during that period. But if you think back to the early 20th century, what states had the power to do in relation to capital, when capital was still largely national and wholly national in the developed world, not in developing countries, was it had the power to break up monopolies, and it had the power to tax companies on its soil. And it did that to varying degrees, depending on what kind of a government was in power. You know, social democratic governments took more tax than conservative ones did. But basically, the state had those two powers. And in this period, era of globalization, basically, those powers have been lost. And there are no supranational organizations that can take on that role, particularly the role of taxing. I mean, just literally, it's really, really difficult to persuade multinational companies to pay tax. They have head offices, you know, in tax havens. They shift money around from country to country. The bargaining power of the state is very, very limited in relation to them. And in terms of breaking up monopolies, it's almost non-existent. I mean, the European Commission has tried, you know, rather feebly, you know, to take on Microsoft and to take on Facebook in relation to some of their more monopolistic powers, but it's by and large failed. So, and this actually creates contradictions for capitalism too, actually, because, you know, when monopolies really become monopolies, that becomes a problem for capitalism. Actually, there are so many contradictions. So I think, but in relation to this privatization thing, I mean, the most extreme example I came across was, I was doing quite a bit of research on this immediately following the financial crisis. I wrote an article, which is actually a chapter in my last book, about the growth of outsourcing of public sector as a new form of commodification. And the only research I could find on it in the UK was a study that had been commissioned by the Department of Business and Industry from an American consultant to measure the size of the outsourced public service, what they call the public service industry in the UK. And this study found that it was equivalent to 6% of GDP. That was in 2006. It was equivalent to 6% of GDP. Oh, that's a hell of a lot. It's bigger than the food, drink, and tobacco industry, for instance. You know, it's really big. But what was more interesting was that this was commissioned by the government as part of, you know, a broader project, so to speak, in response to lobbying from these outsourcing companies. And their sort of political conclusion was that this is a really important industry for Britain. The public sector outsourcing industry is an industry, British companies have a big stake in being outsourced companies, and they have a potential to expand globally and to export this supply of outsourced services. So the government should be encouraging it, even if, It doesn't make sense for the clients, even if it produces the public services more expensively and more inefficiently. The government should nevertheless be supporting these industries because they have export potential. In other words, it was a very clear statement that given the choice, and this was a Labour government, this was New Labour, given the choice, we're on the side of the companies, not on the side of the public sector, right? Old Labour.
You shifting the conversation to how the labour movement might respond to these new kind of circumstances. And what do you make of the claim that the kind of current conjuncture could actually lay the foundations for kind of new forms of cooperation and solidarity? So I'm thinking not only kind of more effective forms of labour that we see in service work, but also kind of like global communication networks and kind of this sort of shared experience of precarity. Or do you think it has kind of the opposite effect? So I'm what comes to mind is the contrast between, say, the sort of delivery strike, which actually made some kind of real material gains in London, and
Leeds and Brighton. Yes.
And I've come to contrast that with my own experience of trying to organise in the hospitality industry, where the kind of sort of precarious nature of the work seems to have the kind of opposite effect. It seems to have a sort of disciplinary effect and sort of defers and puts off any sort of worker solidarity. Are you kind of optimistic or pessimistic about how the workers' movement can respond to?
Well, I don't have much time for this idea that that there is no longer a point of production, you know, that we're all part of this undifferentiated precariat or multitude or whatever you want to say, and that we, it leads to a kind of politics where you work a 70-hour week and do whatever you're told to by your employer, and then go and wave a rainbow flag at an anti-globalisation demonstration at the weekend against some sort of abstraction and feel that you've done something revolutionary. It seems to me that there is still a point of production, that if you're working for any kind of capitalist enterprise in whatever capacity, however individualized your role might feel, if you can work out where you are in the value chain, so to speak, what it is that you're producing and how the value that you produce fits in the chain along with the value that other people produce, then there is in principle a potential for organising. I don't think it's enough just to organise in the workplace, but I think that has to be a starting point. It seems to me one very interesting thing is that the organisation in the so-called gig economy, I hate calling it that, is very much, it's starting among the workers like City Sprint, Deliveroo, etc., Uber Eats, that the workers who actually physically congregate together. That I happen to live opposite one of their congregation points. I can look out of my window and see usually at least five Deliveroo scooters, all with L plates on, waiting for their orders outside my house. Instantly, it's the algorithm that tells them where to congregate. They don't choose where to congregate. They're told by the Deliveroo algorithm. You know, it works out where the customers are, where the suppliers are, etc. But they remind me very much of dockers, 100 years ago, who congregated together at the docks and who are on one level in competition with each other and in another level in solidarity with each other because they get to know each other and they can work together. So it seems to me no accident that it's among the workers who physically congregate together that the new forms of organisation are emerging. It's much, much harder if you're sitting at home doing click work for a site like Clickworker or Amazon Mechanical Turk or whatever, because you're competing with workers from all over the world who you don't know, you're never likely to meet, and you're working completely in isolation. And they're also, you don't have the mechanisms open to you to appeal to the local sort of institutions of one sort or another that can help you. I think you have to make a distinction between online work that's managed by online platforms that can be done anywhere in the world and offline work that's managed by online platforms, which is done in particular places, particular labour markets. So if you're in London or in Birmingham or wherever, you can actually go to whoever the local wages inspector is in theory, or appeal to the authorities that manage to give taxi licenses or whatever it is, that there is an applicable regulatory scheme that applies on that particular territory that that workers can use to help them organize, and that doesn't exist when the work is going across national borders. But having said that, even work that's done locally that's done privately in people's homes is equally hard to organise, like cleaners and window cleaners. I haven't come across any attempts to organise TaskRabbit, for instance. I mean, it could in principle be done, but it would be much harder.
Any other questions? Okay, I think then they're back up there, and thank you, Ursula, again for the